the cops on me. On a mission to be champs since they let me free. Prepare for combat, my adversary crumble. Face it, I got a reputation for damage. Busters get ready to rumble. They lock me in a cell, have me trapped in a living hell. Though not guilty, I'm still in jail. Brother, I serve my time like a soldier. Maintain composure. My shadow boxing the fight to the death. Busting boulders. Every boxer with a pair of gloves. Best give up love. Here's a man from the makings of a thug. A lethal weapon, mine sharp. And in my heart, there's a wish to shake the bread with the flurry of my black fist. Now once a high school dropout.
What's going on, everybody? Another episode of Tuesday's Box Show. Angel here with my boy JP. JP, what's up, man?
Like I said, winter is coming.
Yes, winter is coming.
Yeah.
We're back together, baby. First things first, follow us on Twitter at Cheap Seats Box. iTunes, rate, review. You will be the next unofficial sponsor. You know how we do it? You take the time out to rate and review. We will take the time to shout you out and give you the props on this episode. I have not checked in the last couple of days, so if you have, probably not. email us cheapseatsboxing@gmail.com. Questions, comments, anything like that. Like Patrick Smith sent one in for the show. A lot of times when people email, I just send it right back to him. I don't usually bring it up. He said he wanted brought up on the show. That was easy enough. So that's what we do. We're always interactive with the listeners. Welcome to everybody. All the platforms.
Zoom! God damn it!
The Zoom listener, what's going on? So, special shout out to my boy Polly Malignaggi. Yeah. For some reason, I got a feeling this motherfucker's gonna listen to this show. So, it's all right, man. It's all right, brother. I'll talk to you here in a second. UK was the only spot. Anything going on last week? A fight that I got right as far as I thought who was going to win, but not the way that it ended up going, as Josh Taylor pretty much handles Ahara Davies in seven. JP, what'd you think, man? I mean, the atmosphere was crazy, but somebody shot themselves in the fucking... Uh-huh. They put themselves on the fucking map, you know? And it's funny because our boy Martin... New Age Boxing Podcast. He told us that's a dude you need to be looking for, because I even mentioned Ahara Davies. He goes, "Yeah, you need to be really watching for Josh Taylor." And I mean, I had seen him before, but like he put that spotlight on him. You know what I mean? Like, nah, you really need to. And so I had watched his last two fights as soon as they had come out. You know, the other ones I had seen bits and pieces of on the internet, but damn, he didn't shoot himself up into some notoriety. JP, what'd you think, man?
That dude fought a masterful fight. Now, I don't know why. Something about when southpaws fight, they expose easy stuff that make fighters just lose it. First foremost, I've said this to numerous fighters, especially like Rigo Lomachenko. Manny does it too. He had the foot position. And the weird part about him was he had foot position when he was going right and left. And it's like, you don't realize why it's so hard for you to hit this guy? Why you're throwing your right hand clean over your body and you're getting wore out because you really can't get off any good shots and you're missing? It's because he's in great position. And he was letting Ahara Davies just punch himself out or reach extra to have ineffective shots. And then, on top of that, He took advantage of Ahara Davies in the beginning, fighting that Philly shell. That's a defensive fighting style. You're not supposed to use that as an offensive style, you know? And to start out a fight with that style, when it's a half a body kind of fighting style, where you could walk somebody down and then unload, or fight inside, to be outside like that, you could see the jab coming because he got long arms. And the right, like I said, is on the other side of the body. So it was a beautiful game plan. And then he slowly hit the body. He stayed where he needed to be. Then he started, you knew it was over when it was like maybe about 4 or 5. He started just getting into the center of Ahara Davies. Like, I'm here now, you done. You throwing wild. Your shots are just slow and terrible at this particular point. Yeah, it's whooped. And he embarrassed him. you know, it great boxing. That's all I got. Great boxing. That was a great, great performance. Great game plan, great execution, great performance.
He did something that Josh Taylor did to Ohio Davies. He did, and the word is used so often in boxing, but exposed. He really exposed everything bad about Ohio Davies. And the reason that I think exposed is a proper term in this one is because it's not like Josh Taylor is like 30 fights deep into his professional career. He's got all the professional tricks. Yeah, the amateur pedigree is one thing, but then, you know, he doesn't have all the professional tricks. Still, he's still learning those. Yet somehow he damn near pitched a shutout, because I think the fifth round was, I thought Davies was trying to have one last stand. You know, that he's like, this is it. This is where I'm giving it all. And this is going to be a little. I'm going to dedicate this to another friend of the show, Vince from Tale of the Tape Boxing Podcast. I'm gonna give him my full scorecard. He loves when people give their scorecards. So I know he's cussing right now. He's actually probably fast-forwarding through this podcast as he's hearing it, as I'm saying it. So round one, I gave it to Josh Taylor, you know. But he came out with the jab was strong. He controlled the distance. He controlled where the fight was going. The first two rounds was very businessmanlike, you know what I mean? Establishing the jab, hitting him with the shorter, straighter shots, which I thought if he stayed at that kind of tactics that he would win, but I think it was even easier than he thought. And about the third round, he starts really digging to the body as well. And that's what really impressed me, was how much he went to the body and how strong he went to the body. Davies takes the knee in the third round. I think it was the third round, right? He took the knee.
Right at the end of the round.
Yeah, right at the end of the round, yeah. And so I gave that round, of course, that also is to Taylor, fourth round to Taylor. So I got about four rounds is nothing. That's for you, Vince. But I thought the fifth round, Davies did give his last stand. I thought he had a very strong round. I thought he won the round. And that was kind of impressive. You're like, all right, this guy's got a little bit more left in him. Even though, because I didn't watch the fight live, I was out of town. And so I already knew what had happened, but I wanted to see how it went. And so it kind of opened my eyes, like, hey, look, man, I like the heart that Davey was showing. I didn't realize how it ended. I knew it had ended in the seventh round, but I didn't know how. And then back into the sixth, Davies comes out and tries to fight a little bit more, but that's when Josh Taylor, like, dug to that body, like, to the next level. It was almost like, you want to talk about Mexican style? That body attack was Mexican style. That was Chavez going to the body, like killing the body. Like, the shots to his body, you could hear them throughout. You know what I mean? So you know those were echoing through the arena over there, and it was crazy. And then the seventh, of course, he's finally breaking him down, catches him with that little. He just clipped the chin. Right in that corner, and you barely saw it because the angle, the camera was just changing. So he was like, "What
the fall?"
You're like, "What the fuck just happened? Yeah. What did he hit him with?" They had to slow it down so you could actually see it. He clipped him enough that he knocked him down, and then Davies gets up. Taylor hits him with one good shot, and then he kind of just waved his hands. Davies like, "That's it, that's it." And Taylor's like, "You've been talking a lot of shit leading up to this. The referee ain't jumped in yet. Let me go get you one more shot. Just give me one to, you know, it's almost like you gave him a birthday spanking, you know. One to grow on. Here's one right to grow on, motherfucker, you know. Like, and then, like, as he's getting pulled away, he's talking trash the whole time. Like, who's the bum now, you know?
He took it to him, man.
Yeah, he schooled the shit out of Davies. And it's kind of a beating into the way, like, you have to at this point wonder, how is Davies going to respond after this? Because this could be one of them career defining losses where it's just like, he was never the same. And it's sad when you're only like 15 fights into your career. He was never the same.
And that is, you know, because confidence is one of the hardest things to get back. And he really got schooled. Mm-hmm. Like, really got schooled. But he can learn from this in a way that, you know, he did expose a lot of things that a hard Davies got to touch up. Because, like, one of the weirdest things about that fight when I was looking at Davies was this. You start the fight in the Philly shell from a distance. When he gets close, now you're in a conventional stance.
Yeah, he squares up.
I'm like, what? Wait a minute. You do realize you probably should have started in the conventional stance and then went to the Philly shell when you was tight. Like, with them long-ass arms. But he, you know, if you learn from that lesson, you could take it with you in the future. Taylor, though, yeah, he gave you that work. He gave you that work. As what's up, what? Is it Loaded Lux? You're going to get this work, you know. He gave you that work. That's all I need to tell you.
You know what? I think there was a lot of similarities between the misuse of the Philly shell with O'Hara Davies as there is with Adrian Broner with the Philly shell. The same. That's they think they're Floyd, but they ain't Floyd. And then the misuse is they think they're walking. They're using it to walk their opponent down, but that's not how Floyd uses it. He really uses it up close and on the ropes more than anything else, because he'll square himself up a little bit more at distance to where he does that pullback straight right on you, you know?
But that's the thing. Like, well, Floyd doesn't use the Philly shell, or he called it the Mayweather, in the first round. That's, if you notice his fights, he'll come up ready conventional stance. He works, he changes his style by distance and round. Distance, round, positioning. And what Davies was doing was, he's in the Philly shell, throwing his elbow up like to try to parry a jab. Like, maybe that should be a sign that you way too far. That you like, just waving your elbow up and down just to say, I got to time a jab. No, you don't. Like, if you were actually in the conventional stance, all you have to do was either catch the punch, move the hell out of the way, move your head. That's wasted movement. Like, Broner was doing the same thing. You walk somebody, yeah, you can walk a person down with that, but you have to wear them down enough to walk them down with that. You know? That's like, you don't bum rush somebody in the first round. You ain't Mike Tyson. You know, I'm going to come over there swinging. No, they so fresh, they might knock you out. It's just common sense. You have to use the styles you know when they're appropriate. And that's why I was talking about Taylor's foot positioning. Most fighters, for some odd reason, especially when they fight in southpaws, they don't take into consideration his right foot is over my left foot. And they never pay attention. Why is he a little off to the left? And the corners never tell him, like, yo, watch the feet. You know, they never do that to him. What the hell? My goddamn dad, I'm going to cuss him. Anyway, they never tell him that shit. And what winds up happening is you see the slow breakdown. And I love it when I'm watching it because I can see it coming. You know, and fans, y'all might not know what I'm saying. Try it out. Just Floyd does the same thing with his feet in the position, even with conventional fighters. He controls the distance and the position where he can get off certain shots and you can't. Matter of fact, Andre Ward and Kovalev, the shot that hurt Kovalev, that's the same exact shot that he got him knocked down by Kovalev. The same exact shot that he knocked down Chad Dawson with. But when you like, the same way, he walked a little over to line him up for the shot, and he caught him. He caught him while he was in that space of trying to move to. It's the timing and the movement. If you can get that if the corners could get that, they can adjust to it. Most fighters, for some odd reason, don't get it when the fight's going on. You know, that's just my thought on that.
You know, I think the wording might have been off too with the with walking him down was putting pressure on him. Like Broner and Davis was using it to try to put pressure on him. Like I'm in your face, I'm in your face. That's not where Floyd uses it to control distance, control the tempo of the fight. Where they're using it, like I'm in your face, I'm in your face. But what happens is you get in there with a boxer who can create their own space, or can pick the holes out in the space that you've given them, or three can bang on the inside. So if you're close on them and they're banging and you're fighting out of more of a defensive posture, where they're going to be hitting you way more times than you're hitting them. He had the same issue when Broner had it with Maidana and Porter. Mm-hmm. They're like, well, shit, you're perfect. You're right into where I want to fight. And even Floyd had that same issue a little bit with Maidana the first time until he learned, okay, I got to control this, you know.
Right.
But when you have a boxer with that kind of skill set like Taylor has, and I think he brought one more aspect to the game that even Davies wasn't expecting, was he had a mean streak in him. When he was digging those body shots, when I said Mexican style, he was doing it to hurt him. He was trying to punish him. He was like, I don't think he was expecting Taylor to be that effective in close, on inside fighting. He thought, well, he's going to want to pick me from the outside. I'm going to get inside. And then as soon as Taylor's like, nah, I can take what you're throwing at me, and now let's get dirty. And I don't think he expected that. It was one more thing that he didn't expect, and he had zero game plan for anything else than what he was doing. That was it. The game plan was one. There was no 1B. There was no plan See, nothing. It was just one.
And that's why, that's why I like boxers. Because usually boxers have a game plan. It's usually, I'm going to try this. If this don't work, I'm going to try this. If this don't work. And it's not necessarily, boxer doesn't mean a particular style. It means a person who actually wants to hit you, not get hit, but also has a plan to systematically break you down. You know, like, you would talk about Chavez Sr. He knew, okay, I might not win 1-4. But if I keep doing this, 5-12 is mine. And that's a plan. That's a game plan. Like, look, don't worry. It's gonna work. We got confidence in the system. Most boxers have confidence in the system. And if you make a fighter, if you come with a great game plan, you make a fighter have to adjust, and they only know how to do one thing well, it creates a snowball effect of problems. Just like Manny Pacquiao is a particular type of fighter. But once he gets rolling, most people can't handle the avalanche. They can't handle, oh, shit, he's feeling it. But that was the thing about him and Marquez. Marquez like, okay, I can't fight him his way. The shit's not going to work. But I'm going to pick a spot, and then hit him with this. Hit him with this. You know, and that's why those fights were so great, because the flow was back and forth and back and forth, because as Manny would start out super fast, or he'd start tagging that ass, you'd see, damn, that was a nice pot shot. Oh, that was a nice pot. Okay, that's two. All right, wait a minute. He unloading on him like... And it's always the back and forth, because if you have a game plan, you work it, you believe in it, it actually works. You know, that's the thing to me about even with Adrian Broner. Sometimes he doesn't change his game plan. Like, he's a strong fighter. Everybody says that. He's a big, strong, powerful dude for his size. But that's not what got him to be the four-time champ. What got him to be the four-time champ was a combination puncher. Was a guy who would, you know, work you in and out. Is a guy who would overpower you in the midst of the combination, not walk you down and just bang you with the hardest shot he could. His stance wasn't as wide back then. You know what I'm saying? So it's that type of stuff. Like, look, if I know I can knock you out, why knock you out in the first round when I could slowly beat you down to the point you're so slow that I could really unload on you? And that's what Taylor was doing. He got Davies to the point where he could round, you know, 4, 5, 6, 7. I could really unload on you now. Now I'm in your wheelhouse and there ain't nothing you could do about it because you're discombobulated, you're spent, you're frustrated, and you're weak. So who cares if you hit me with an uppercut or a hook? It don't have anything on it no more. You know, but like I said, that's how people, that's my opinion.
And we'll see if Taylor can get his Ricky Burns fight. Ricky Burns, did you watch the whole post fight? I don't think he wanted a lot of these. We can fill up a stadium. In other words, we'll fill up an arena. In other words, he's like, we better fill up an arena, and I better get paid a lot of money if you really want this fight. That's how it's going to have to go down. Let's talk more scorecards. The WBO revisited the Pacquiao Horn fight and had it rescored by 5 independent judges who were all anonymous. Breaking news. You'll hear it here on Cheap Seats Boxing first. I got the names of the 5 people who scored the fight. Paul Hogan was one. Russell Crowe was the other. Mr. and Mrs. Horn and Grandma Horn. Now, all 4 of them scored it for Horn. 1 was Grandma Horn. She scored it for Pacquiao because if there's one thing your grandma's always going to do, she's always going to keep it real with you. So, it's amazing how an internal investigation always comes back clean. Our judges had it right.
And
you know?
The department says nothing wrong was done.
There's nothing to see here. Keep moving along. It's not like we thought anything was going to change. So that's whatever, you know. But I think it's the farce of them actually trying to, like, we would believe that this actually was rescored and okay.
Here's my thing. People got busted for steroids and you didn't change it, right? It still counts as a win. So now that you scored a win, you going to unscore it? No. You know, it's a waste of time. You know, I mean, people might be able to just shoot your shot. Take that crap shot and see if it works for you. But really, it's a waste of time. You know? Now, when you rewatch the fight, you still say Horn won? Here's the thing. I could justify Horn winning 5 rounds. Because, man, he started slow and he kept taking breaks. But I will say maybe about 2 through 7, 9, probably 11, I get those many. Now, you can, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, I mean.
It's hard to come up with the rounds that like, you want. And, you know, I think, I'm going to be honest with you, because ESPN didn't have their camera crew at the A lot of it was an Australian-based. From what they're saying is like whoever does their fights and their stuff. So, you know, the camera was pretty jumpy. You know, it bounced around a lot. They didn't seem to have set cameras, you know.
Right.
And so, like, their angles, a lot of times it was hard to see some of, like, especially on camera, some of Manny's work on this. Like, you literally had to watch for it. Like, oh, he's catching him with short shots that you're not even seeing. And it, look. Not to revisit the whole thing, but there's a reason that fight was almost stopped in the 9th. It wasn't because he just got beat down in the 9th. There was a sustained beating up until the 9th that took place. And there's a reason that Horn's face was beat up. And Manny's really had no marks on his face. He had it on his head. And let's be honest, Manny marks up a lot nowadays. I mean, he was marked up against Jesse Vargas. He was marked up a little bit with Tim Bradley. He was marked up a little bit, not that much, with Floyd. But I'm saying he marks up. So, like, these shots that he was supposedly getting caught with, he didn't mark up at all. And he's not a guy who doesn't bruise, you know what I mean? He doesn't show it. He's a guy who does show it.
I got to say this. On the flip side, you got to give Horn credit. That motherfucker got heart.
Mm-hmm.
And for some of y'all who don't know, he did fight Randall Bailey. And he did get up off the canvas. And if you don't know who Randall Bailey is, just don't. If you meet a guy named Randall Bailey in public, don't get punched by him.
Oh, Stephen A. Smith definitely does not know who Randall
Bailey is. I know. I said, yeah, you know, like, you don't ever want to get punched by. Nobody wants to really get punched by Randall Bailey.
Doesn't everybody come off the canvas against Randall Bailey at some point if they didn't get knocked out, if they beat him?
I mean, I'm just saying, but that's a hell of a chance to take. You won out of 40-something people, you know, because the people that won, they don't remember that night. But, you know, he's a tough dude. And I say, you know, what he did was, it's one of those things, even with the home field advantage, he out-hustled. Mm-hmm. He out-hustled Manny. And that hustle counted that. You know, you in your hometown, and in your home country. It's a continent, I shut up. Look.
It's both.
Yeah, whatever. You know, you at home, people counted your heart, and it happens. I expect shit like that. You know, that's why I said before, you know, when people come to the U.S. to fight and they not from here, they expect that they probably gonna get screwed if they win. If you from the U.S. and you go to the U.K., you expect. So, Manny, I don't even expect him to have a rematch. You know, I expect him to. He's not fighting Spence. He's not fighting Vargas. He might fight Bradley because he might feel like Bradley can't hurt him. You know, I don't see him fighting anybody that can hit him hard.
Can you imagine those two heads going right against each other?
He'll lose on that one. You're not headbutting Timothy Bradley.
Bradley versus Horn would look like, you know, when they show them Rams going together and they're running and. Boom! What it would look like.
I don't know about that. That's one Ram. That's one hell of a Ram, goddammit. Yeah. Bradley ain't playing with them headbutts.
Nah, he's got it down.
And Horn ain't going to be. You think he was fucked up after? Try to headbutt Bradley if you want to.
All right. This week, there's a few fights on. We'll start at the bottom of the barrel for me. Omar Figueroa versus Robert Guerrero, the ghost of the ghost. On PBC, Fox, I mean, like I said, this is where the Easter fight should have been, and this fight should have been on Bounce. It's a guy that ain't got anything left. The last we saw him, he was losing to a cab driver, literally a fucking cab driver. Losing last year also to Danny Garcia. And the Aaron Martinez fight, everybody thought he got a gift decision. And so, I mean, this guy is on a roll, and it's backwards. It ain't forward. And Omar Figueroa, he hasn't fought in how long now? I mean, it's got to be, what? It's at least a year and a half? 2 years?
And actually, it might make it a closer fight because of the rust. Because honestly, Figueroa is like up and down. You know, up and down, up and down. And the ghost is, well, not up and down.
He's down.
But at the same time, you never count a champion out. You know, like, they can always have that one last stand. So, would it be the best fight that I would like to see? Not really. I mean, it kind of reminds me of when Quillen was younger and he fought Winky Wright, you know. Who the hell is this? Well, you're going to find out. But this could be that moment. Or this could be one of Bernard Hopkins revisited, you know, beating Tov ass, beating Pavlik ass, you know, beating Pascal. Like, damn, the old man actually pulled this shit off. So it could go either way. Because, you know, you take ring rust versus experience. Just don't let Robert get confident. That's your number one goal. If you Omar Figueroa, don't let this dude start feeling himself. Because that's when you're going to have a problem.
Well, he didn't have power at 130. This is all the way up at 147. So he's not going to have any power to keep Guerrero off of him. It actually probably is one of his better matchups for him. could. But, I mean, that, even if he won, man, I don't want him to win because then he's going to think he's up for a title shot again. And you're not. You know?
Well, okay. I mean, let's put it like this. If he wins and he's up for a title shot, you fight Errol Spence. Do you really want that?
Yeah, exactly.
You don't want that. You don't want that problem. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you win and you want contention for a title shot, you might wind up fighting Kell Brook. Because Danny Garcia and Spence are supposed to be trying to go at it. So, or you might wind up fucking having to fight Sean Porter. Yeah, that's not a good idea. Like, but anybody say, look, if you just give me a chance is all I need. I understand that, but you know that division is deep. I mean, win or loss, the next fight might be him and Berto rematch. Off of.
See, I don't need to see that shit either.
I'm just saying, but, you know, with the Josecito fight, that was, not the Josecito, the Ortiz fight, that was great, you know, and in the rematch, they built on that. And they probably do the same thing.
Yeah.
Because both of those guys are, like, at the tail end of it, you know? So, I mean, that's the... But if you want to take on one of these guys who's still in their prime, it's not going to work out well. I mean, it's just not. Figueroa, I don't know what you're going to do.
Nobody knows.
Shit. I don't know, bro. Like, I don't know.
All right, the day starts off UK for the last spot in the prestigious World Boxing Super Series tournament. The forgotten bracket of the super middleweights will be filled by the winner of Chris Eubank Jr. and Arthur Abraham. I mean, again, I don't think there's much to say about this. If Eubank Jr. can't beat a guy like Arthur Abraham, who we saw in the fight against Gilberto Ramirez, has almost zero left. If he can't beat a guy like this, then there's nothing. I mean, honestly, if he was to lose, then I would even say Arthur Abraham needs to get out of this goddamn tournament, because that would mean Arthur Abraham is up for a 3-spot in that tournament. On that side, on that bracket, it doesn't say much. I expect Eubank Jr. to batter him. He's not going to knock him out, I don't think. But, you know, he'll beat him up for 12 and probably get a nice wide decision.
You already know what I said. Both of them going to wind up in a damn tournament. I don't know how it's going to happen. Winner and loser are going to wind up in a tournament. It's just, you know, they've taken the Super 6 to the next level, you know, both with those middleweights and the cruiserweights. But I could see a, you know, Money in the Bank match. Somebody just comes out of nowhere, you know. Oh, man, this is looking good. And then, whose theme music is this? Yeah, I thought he lost that. That has nothing to do with this shit. Just a name recognition alone. You know. So.
You're trying to say Jürgen Brammer may get a mysterious injury leading up to the tournament, and somehow Arthur Abraham still fills in?
What's the ice skater? Why?
Nancy,
there you go. Somebody comes around.
Jeff Galuli's gonna come around with a lead pipe.
Yeah.
Bow! Right on Jürgen Brammer's knee.
Right, no tournament for your ass.
The big card is on HBO. I give HBO credit. They're starting to pick up a little steam. And next month, is it next month? September, no, 2 months. September 9th with Superfly card. They're starting to pick it up. The one thing is, I'll give them this, when they're giving us cards, they're actually giving us better cards and triple hitters, which they hadn't been doing. The triple header starts off Sullivan Barrera, Joe Smith. Great fight. Great fight. This one, honestly, it's easy because this is a 50-50 fight. This is easy to make a case for both of these fighters. Who you got, man?
Shit, I don't know. Joe Smith's on a confident roll. I mean, come on now. You demolish from far, you demolish Bernard. Barrera's on a comeback, pretty much. Losing a Ward ain't necessarily a loss, because it's fucking Ward. Let's just be real. But the question is, I think Smith will go for the knockout. Does Barrera's skill set says he has what it takes to get Smith off of him, but I don't know if his power has what it takes to get him out of there. So this is skill versus will or power fight, and I don't know what to call this one. I flip a coin, like depending on who get their nuts taken first. That's basically what happens, because I mean, if I look at it, if the game plan would be, if Smith comes out smoking and you can survive that, you have a chance of winning. Now, if you come out smoking, you might win. Because you get a lead and you have to force him to try to open up and, you know, kill him with counter shots, because he's a Cuban fighter. Like, he playing that game with you all day. But the question is, 1 through 4, can you make it? I don't know. So shit, I got my money on a wash, a push. I can't fuck with it right now.
I'm gonna go Joe Smith on this fight. The one thing that Barrera has been susceptible to, even in his last win against Czesław Szybranski, was he got knocked down. Mm-hmm. Got knocked down against Ward. Well, Joe Smith hits harder than both of those guys. I think that's been proven out. And if he catches him early, when he gets you hurt, he's a killer. That's the one thing he has. I think that his will beat out Barrera's skill. It's like I said, it's still a 50-50 fight. It's easy to make the case the other way around. But I think the fact that he's susceptible to being knocked down, that just it's blood in the water for a guy like Joe Smith. And even, you know, people now, oh yeah, Fanfara was a shell of himself. He still knocked him out quicker than even Adonis Stevenson did afterwards. It still took him 2 rounds to knock him out. So he got him out of there and won. And we saw what he did to Hopkins. He did to Hopkins what even Sergey Kovalev could do it. Yeah. I mean, he knocked him down, but never like that. I mean, he had him going all old school against Chad Dawson, you know, faking injuries to, my ankle, I'm going to say Smith knocks him down early, maybe even a couple times. And I think he's going to – I think that he may not – I don't think he's going to end up stopping him, but I think he's going to get a couple of knockdowns early, and it's going to get Barrera into retreat mode to where he's going to win a lot of rounds based on pressure and aggressiveness and telling shots to where – where Barrera, he's a guy who wants to bang. He will bang with you.
Yeah.
And I think that he will get that beat out of him to where he will be back into the boxer mode, which will show that Smith is actually controlling the fight.
What was that fight we watched, we did a while back ago with Endom, and I forgot who it was. He kept knocking Endom down.
Oh, hold on. Let's see. Canadian, Triple G, the hair.
Lemieux?
David Lemieux. That's how my brain works. Yeah.
when it was a great fight, but every time Endom tried to get back in a fight, bow.
Was it four knockdowns?
Yeah.
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 I think the spread was four. Literally, it was just the knockdowns. It was kind of like the Glavatsky and also Cunningham. The same thing, where the knockdowns was what separated that fight. It could be that kind of fight. I think you're right. It could be looking just like that. Well, I think he's going to win a decision based off knockdowns. It's going to probably be, like you said, a wash as far as number of rounds. But I see Smith knocking down Barrera more than I could see the other way around. It's a great opening bout. The second fight, Jezreel Corrales, Robinson Castellanos. Now, Corrales, they just signed with Golden Boy. Got the title from Takashi Uchiyama. And Castellanos coming off the win against Gamboa. Also has a couple more scalps on his resume. Don't let the record fool you. He's an Orlando Salido type. I think he was 3-7 in his first 10, 14-2 since. older, definitely rugged. But these are the guys that scare you, because a guy like Corrales comes in, because this is your first show, your first fight with Golden Boy. But gotta also remember what Golden Boy's been doing. Give Golden Boy credit. They've been putting their dudes in fucking hard. So if Corrales thinks that he's coming in as this is a showcase, this is anything but a showcase. If the recent history of Golden Boy has showed us they're going to put their guys in hard, give them credit. I didn't think even the Triple G fight was going to happen with Canelo. They still did it when they said they were going to do it. So they're putting their guys in hard. I say Corrales ekes out a decision like 7-5, but he's going to be fighting for his fucking life against a guy like Castellanos.
I'm going to have to go the other way. Not just because of that. Mm-hmm. You know them Japanese fighters are hell on wheels. So you go from one, you go from that shit.
To a crazy Mexican fight.
We're like, you. Now you make that one. You able to pull that shit off. It's probably all downhill. But it is a hard fucking thing to pull off. You know, it might just be wear and tear, battle of attrition by the time you get to round six. Like, fuck, come on, man. Like, could somebody get rid of this motherfucker or something? So that's why I think that the combination of those two fights back to back might be too much. But it's great that you put him in tough.
Yeah.
Because if he loses that, he should get a rematch on that shit. Because, you know, that's the way I feel. That's just my opinion on it. But,
The main event. Miguel Berchelt versus Takashi Miura. They both have Francisco Vargas as their common opponent. Miguel Berchelt wore down and put a beating on Francisco Vargas. What, did he stop him in the 11th?
Yeah, it was late. It was late.
And Takashi Miura got stopped late against Vargas in a fight that he was winning and probably looked like he was on his way to stopping Vargas.
Yeah. I'm going Miura, Takashi.
Yeah, you think over the younger Berchelt, huh?
Look, just because he lost, you know how much you got to do to keep him off of your ass? I don't think Berchelt is ready for that mentality right now. He's a young lion, but you really got to fight to the death. You know, and that, a lot of times, that's not, the person on the other side of that, that's really more of a mental wear on them. Vargas made it out by the skin and hair on his chinny chin chin. Takashi's about to come the same fucking way. So what, I lost. So what? Fuck it. I'm doing this again. I think that's a lot of pressure mentally. Not just physically, but mentally.
So we're going opposite sides. I like it. We're going opposite sides on a lot of things, because I'm going Berchelt. I'm going the chalk. I'm walking the chalk on this one. I think Berchelt, the younger guy, is going to wear him down. I mean, Miura's getting older. He's got some battle. But you're right as far as, because I don't know if Berchelt has the, because it basically was one shot that changed that fight with Vargas and Miura. So I don't know if Berchelt has that, but he also keeps on fucking coming. This is going to, this fight, it's almost impossible for it to suck. These motherfuckers are just going to go in and just, probably from the opening bell until whenever somebody falls or the final bell. This shit is going to go. I'm going to go Berchelt. It's going to be a tight, close. Everybody's going to be talking about this fight on Twitter, everywhere else. Everybody's going to be like, man, hey, turn on HBO. It's time to turn that shit on. So we're going to go opposite on that fight on two of the three fights.
It's going to be fun.
Let's finish up. Like we're talking about the super series of boxing, whatever the fuck they're calling this shit. And look, I know it's 50 million total, right? But let's be honest, 40 of the million should be going to the cruiserweights, because the cruiserweights are really carrying this tournament. I don't care. It's funny because super middleweight, it's got names in it. The names generally aren't in this tournament, but in this tournament, I think the bigger names, even though they're cruiserweights, the more noticeable names are on the cruiserweight side. So we look. George Groves is first. He's fighting Jamie Cox. I'm not even gonna go through all the matchups. Callum Smith, who's still like a 35 year old. I think he's. I don't know. It's a lie. He's not 35, but he's that perennial prospect. Been top prospect for 5 years now. Then he's fighting Eric Skoglund out of Sweden. Then you just got fillers in there. Abraham Eubank winner is going to be in there. Like I said, you got the corpse of Jürgen Brammer. Brandt, the American, is a dark horse because he's unknown. I'm not putting a lot into the super middleweight part of it. It doesn't even pique my interest really that way. If Groves and Smith isn't, or it's going to come down to Groves versus the winner of Callum Smith, Eubank Jr. in the semifinals. It's almost like that one's easy to see. Even though the cruiserweights, it's easy to see that the top two go into the end, but you know there's going to be fucking hell to pay in between the first round to the finals.
The problem with me just watching this from afar, the cruiserweights got all the killer instincts. So that's where the attention should be, even though it's like a disrespected division. That's got more killer instinct. They got like 4 undefeated fighters. How the fuck Mike Perez gonna make cruiserweight? I don't know.
No, well, he made it last time, that's why.
Yeah, but still, he's a big dude.
He's off his cycle, man. I mean, he's good now. Have you seen him?
A big dude. Yeah, but he's still
fucking shredded.
It's like when I look at the Big Show now, I'm like, who the fuck is that? Like, it's weird, but it's a great part of it, because you actually have a heavyweight. Usually the cruiserweights go up, you know what I'm saying? You got a heavyweight that went down. So you, is that power aspect of it, even though he, ever since that fight with
Abdul Salamov,
it's been up and down, and that's understandable. That's really understandable. But you got him, you got Russia, you got Cuba, you got America, I think you got Poland. You know, you really got like the U.S., you really got like an international fight with some names that you know and some names that you don't know, but a lot of killer instinct, a lot of high knockout percentage. You know, that's, somebody is going to come out really, really supremely on top when this is over with. And you might see a guy in a year go from not necessarily virtually unknown but rarely talked about to stardom or superstardom, depending on how they get rid of the opposition. So, I mean, I think it's a great move for the cruiserweight division. I really do. I think it's like a great move.
All right, let's go through the, like I said, I wasn't going to spend too much on the super middles, but the cruiserweight division is like, it's fucking loaded. And then the one thing that I thought was, that I would have liked to see for the cruiserweights, was all of the fights take place from the beginning of 2018 to the end, because whoever wins this cruiserweight tournament really should be a fighter of the year, because they're going through fucking hell in that division. They're getting 4 champions. Fuck Lebedev, he's not a champion. He lost to Gus. Yeah, fuck that bullshit. We'll take, who is it? Bradis' regular belt or whatever the fuck it is. We'll take that over Lebedev's. But they will have earned and went through a gauntlet of fighters to win a fighter of the year. Even next year, when the semifinals and the finals next year, is going to put them in line for fighter of the year. It's funny because all the buzz in boxing has been about the cruiserweight division. It's not been about the super middles, which is odd, because we've known the names, we see them here and there. They're not the easiest fights to always get a hold of. You actually have to work to fucking find these fights. Usyk's been on TV the last couple of times. Garcia has been on TV, but the rest of these guys, and Mike Perez, but that was as a heavyweight here on the stateside, you know. But the fact that they got to call out their opponents was amazing. Just the fact, basically looking like, I can beat your ass. It's basically what you're saying. Usyk takes on Marco Huk the first fight. It's the corpse of Huk against the skill set of Usyk. It doesn't seem to be Unless the old timers got one last run in them. You know what I mean? Yeah, I don't think so.
Like Carl Lewis's last 100. I don't know, B.
Gassiev, who actually didn't get to pick his opponent. And I guess if... I don't know how this was going to work. I guess if Usyk picked Vladarchuk, then he was going to get a hook. I don't know how it fucking worked. But anyway, Murat Gassiev, he gets his mandatory against Vladarchuk in the first round. That, I think, is also another one that's a pretty clear victor in that one. Gassiev is going to win. He's probably going to knock him out. Then the last two matchups, I think, are where, like, it really opens up. Like, I like...
It's interesting.
Yeah.
It's interesting.
Because what does the Irish Cuban have in Mike Perez at Cruiser against Marius Bredas, who had just came off of his fight against Hook? Perez actually has enough skill to win, honestly, to win the whole thing. I just don't know if he has the heart or anymore, like you said, after. He's never been the same.
Right. Like I said, it's that's difficult, you know, because some people can move on after that, some people can't. It's not a bad thing because, you know, even though it's a hurt business, you don't want to be that guy. You know what I'm saying? You don't mean to do that type of stuff, but you still don't want to. It'll linger with you. You know, a few people are move forward like Kovalev did. I even think that type of thing. I think when Sugar Ray Robinson had killed a guy, I mean, that fucked with him. You know, it's like, you know, when you hurt somebody, it just God bless both of y'all, because, you know, both of you got to live with that, you know.
Some people doesn't bother at all. Nigel Benn.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, he's just chilling. He's like, hey, man.
But it might not.
That might be his public face. Privately, he might be like, look, man, I don't even want to talk about that night.
I think the final matchup, that's the most interesting. It's the two guys who are the least known, the Cuban Dorticos and the Russian Kudryashov. Now, I'm doing this off memory. I'm looking up the box wrecks and stuff. Dorticos, 21-0 with
17.
Is it with 17? Oh, I thought it was 20.
I might get them mixed up. 20. It's
20. It's 21-0 with 20 knockouts, right? And where am I looking at? And I know Kudryashov is 21-1 with 21 knockouts. That's going to be, I think,
a motherfucker.
Yeah, because the one chink in Kudryashov's armor is the loss, and it was a TKO too. So somebody is going down and going to sleep in this fight. The first round is going to be, I think those two are going to steal the show as far as, and I know they're individually done each week for 4 weeks in a row. So they're not going to be on the same show. But as far as, they're going to steal the thunder of the first round, I think. The winner of that fight is going to steal the thunder because they're both bringing the thunder and one of them's going down. It's put like this. Because of how that fight is most likely going to end, there's going to be people who go, Usyk, you know, may be in for some fucking trouble in that second round. If they're going to do it by seeds. If they're doing it by seeds. I still haven't looked at all the rules. I don't know how the second round goes. And the carrot being dangled out there with the $1 million for the winner of each round, of the first round, one and a half in the second round. That's a lot of shit to dangle out. So these motherfuckers are going to go for knockouts.
That's the thing. That makes it great. Because, ironically, it's kind of like the UFC thing when you get paid for the knockout.
I think that there's one in there for that, too.
You know, it's like knockout of the night, you get the bone. Like, they're actually pushing the limit. They're pulling out all the stops to get that division back. Back to notoriety, which I like it. And plus, you got people that actually commit on doing it. And what's crazy about it is, if you make like that fight the first fight, everybody know what the end for after that. It's like, you know, they probably won't make that fight the first fight per se because of the name recognition. Mm-hmm. But if you were to make that fight the first fight, it would, what was that? Like,
Usyk's kicking it off.
Yeah, I know, but it's but that fight is going to be like, and it wasn't the fight with Danny Jacobs and Sergio. It was the other fight. Was it Delvin Rodriguez and Top Dog?
Thomas Williams?
Yeah, when those were the two, you're like, shit! Like,
you know what we're talking about? The money part of it, which is a big thing, and I think that's why the cruiserweights, that's why all the top cruiserweights jumped in, because like, fuck, this is more money than we're ever going to make. It's going to do two things. Your knockout fighters, I think it's going to push them to get a knockout earlier. Like, I want to be done with this shit, get ready for the next round. Where I think the boxers, like a Mike Perez, definitely Alexander Usyk, you may see them go into cruise control. Because, like, well, I don't want to hurt my hand. Where the dangling of that extra money for the win and another $1.5 million in the second round, it's going to be like, I'm not going to put myself at risk. I mean, I know I can just stick it from the outside. I think it's going to make, it has the potential to make the boxers more more skittish of getting in there and banging. But I think it's going to make the bangers more wanting and willing to go in there and just get it over with. Let's get the shit. We won't get paid the same no matter what.
You know, like, that's the thing about just the knockout, because you know, I could see somebody like Mike Perez, because he was a heavyweight, let you punch yourself out. And because he was a heavyweight, he might have had an extra power to put you out maybe in the fourth or fifth. You know, like, okay, you came out here swinging. I'm still here, now what? You know? And that, I think that's what that money actually also jumps into, because at the end of the day, people are going to go out, let's finish it. And you're going to see people gassed by round three. Because if it ain't over by round three, their mouth's going to be open. The punch is going to get wild. They're going to need a break. It's going to be that Joshua Klitschko, somebody got to survive now, you know? Which, for entertainment purposes, is great. You know, it's just like, shit, either you knock them out, you gas out, now you got to fight for your life to be able to win. And, you know, hopefully you knock the opponent out. It's really a no-lose situation for fans, you know? I'm glad they're pulling out all the stops. I really am.
It's definitely going to shine a light on the cruiserweight division that really hasn't been there really since Evander Holyfield. And that's a good thing. We'll go ahead and we'll close it off there. I don't think there's nothing next week, too. That's what sucks, man. It's going to be another slow. At least we have a lot to review. It'll be a lot to review.
Don't worry about it.
You know, maybe me and Polly get back into it again. Polly, you like I said, you're more than welcome to come on here. And trust me, this ain't Twitter. I'm not going to be disrespectful.
And I like you. So, yeah.
Honestly, like you, I don't dislike you, but when you're hypocritical, I call you out on it. I ain't got a problem with it.
You over there studying like, motherfucker, you hypocritical too. I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about, Paulie. That wasn't me, man. It wasn't me.
Oh. Hey, that's that East Coast, West Coast thing, man. You that fast talking, loud East Coast thing? I'm just a laid back West Coast dude, man. That shit don't bother me.
I ain't got shit to do that. It's Midwest and South. I don't know if y'all can handle that.
I would love for Paulie to come on here. You know, just to tell me why I don't know what I'm talking about, just because I ain't never been in a professional fighter before. I mean, I know what I see. I ain't never played professional football, but I know what the fuck I'm seeing when I'm watching the game.
Hey, man, look, I played Mike Tyson punch out with the best of them. I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. I tell you what, I got more knockouts in the street than he's got in the ring.
Oh, shit. He might say, you don't know how many I got in the street, though. Like, I don't know.
Nah, I've seen them. He ain't got much. Oh, I'm just fucking with him, man. That's fun. I never get into Twitter beefs. That was fun, man. I don't get in that very often. That was like my first one.
Well, if that does happen, you know, it's cool. If that does happen, you got to at least do the baby comment, Paul. Is you finished? Is you done? Like, you put some respect on it. We got, yeah, just have a little fun with it.
All right, we'll end it there. Follow the show on Twitter at Cheap Seats Box. iTunes, rate and review. You'll be the next unofficial sponsor. That's what we do. You take the time out to rate and review. We take the time out to acknowledge you guys. It keeps the show more noticeable. We appreciate everybody who takes the time out to do it. You can email us, cheapseatsboxing@gmail.com. Questions, comments, anything like that. JP, is there anything else, man?
Shout out to Pritchard Cologne. You know, I hope it continues to get better. This is where the fighters fighting the fans commentate.
And we do it just like you from the Chief Seats. You ain't buying no tickets, goddammit. No, sorry, Paulie, still not. Peace. Call me crazy, but no one can fake me. I'm the product of the projects. Lost the crazy.